Good evening and welcome to the Observatory Night. I'm Doug Finkbeiner, professor in astronomy and physics here, and I have the honor of introducing our distinguished speaker tonight, Professor Natarajan from Yale. I guess it's not unusual to advertise a book at these things, but I have a little story to go with it. My wife is in a band, and one of the very talented musicians in the band came up to me after their last concert and said, "I'm reading this new book on cosmology. I can't remember the author's name. I'll send it to you, but it's a really good book. I'm telling everyone to read it." I said, okay, that's nice. So I got home and had an email from her and said, "It's Priya Natarajan. Have you heard of her?" I said, "Well, actually, I've known her for 20 years. and I'll be introducing her at this." And in fact, we met in 1996 at a little winter school in Jerusalem, of all places, back when she was a graduate student of Martin Rees. She was then also a postdoctoral fellow in Cambridge, Trinity College, for a while, and then briefly a visiting scholar at CETA in Toronto before landing at Yale over 10 years ago, where she's been ever since. She's a frequent visitor here. She was the Bigelow Fellow at Radcliffe in 2008, and won a Guggenheim Fellowship the next year, spent some time here. We also organized a conference together last year, actually. So she's a frequent visitor. She has a long list of honors I won't bore you with. She's been elected a fellow of the RAS, the APS, lots of other acronyms, the Explorer Club. She is the Sophie and Tycho Brahe Professor at the Dark Institute and the Cosmology Center at the University of Copenhagen. She's an honorary professor for life at the University of Delhi, and so on. She's worked on too many research areas to mention, so I picked three. Gravitational lensing. She's works on how you use weak lensing to look at galaxy clusters and the mass distribution and the large-scale structure and the shapes of dark matter halos. So she's actually looking at where the dark matter is by how it bends the light. She's looked at accretion rates of black holes, AGN quasars, all these things where material falls in a black hole and outflows come out. And this has impacts on galaxy evolution and other things that are very interesting. And she's also looked into binary black holes and how they merge and make gravitational wave signals, which has been of great interest in the last couple of years. So I could go on, but you came to hear from her and not me, and I promised her to keep it to 3 minutes. So, Priya Natarajan.
Thank you so much, Doug, for that very kind introduction. So it's a real pleasure. Oh gosh, the spotlight is just on me. It's a little spooky. It's a real pleasure and a privilege to have the opportunity. It's asking for a password. I don't know the password. Uh-oh.
No pressure
at all. Right? I know. Thank you. Thank you very much. So, what I wanted to, let's see, moment of truth? It should work, yeah. So, as Doug mentioned, in addition to doing research, I've had a sort of abiding interest in the history of ideas, in the history of radical scientific ideas. And finally, I decided a couple of years ago that I would like to write a book. And so this is my first book. And I want to talk a little bit about what motivated me to write this book. And then I want to delve into two radical ideas in cosmology and sort of trace the arc of acceptance of those two radical ideas. So that's sort of what I do in the book. I pick, I look at the last 100 years in cosmology. 100 years because it's been a very transformative time. 100 years ago, we did not even know that other galaxies existed. So we barely knew that, you know, we were only one galaxy among trillion others. And the astronomer Edwin Hubble finally realized, he showed that the Milky Way was but one galaxy, and the other little smudges that you see in the night sky are the external galaxies. And so in the intervening 100 years, as we'll see, I'll give you a little bit of a synopsis of where we are at. We've learned a tremendous amount. However, these radical ideas, the discovery of the expansion of the universe, the discovery of black holes, dark matter, dark energy, and now, as you all know, the discovery of exoplanetary systems around other nearby stars. So it's been an era of tremendous progress, and in particular, the last 20, 25 years, I feel very fortunate to have been, sort of that has overlapped with the start of my career, and there's been a real grand convergence in the sense that the sophistication of theoretical ideas, the instrumental capabilities, the technology that we've had to look at the universe through various wavelengths, and the computational power that we have to interpret that data, there's been a real grand convergence. So they've really, these things have lined up, and that's why the pace of discoveries is just so rapid at the moment. So with this twinkling screen, okay. As I said, and the other thing that I have always been invested in is the sort of understanding of the public dissemination of not just the latest discoveries in science, which is very exciting, which a lot of us do now routinely, but also I feel very compelled to help the public understand the process of science, because I strongly believe that the current climate in which we have such rampant denialism of science arises not from the fact that people don't understand the content of science, but from the fact that the process of science and particular features of science, which are what scientists find exciting, but the curious public don't quite understand, is what's responsible for the denialism. And I think that it's the fact that science is provisional by nature. Our understanding is best to date, and that it, as scientists, we are trained to always be nimble and be open to changing our mind, because you have new data and you have new evidence, then you may have to rethink your interpretation and therefore your theoretical frameworks even. Often, though, new data causes you just to refine and hone your current understanding. And it's very rarely that you have a complete overthrow. That has happened, but it doesn't happen all that often. So my goal is to sort of show, you know, the process of science. And I think that's what I try to do in the book. And I'll try to give you a flavor of that tonight when I speak. And personally, I've been very interested in the human and the psychological side of science, because I think part of what has happened is that when scientists talk about the work, there's this notion that scientists are these objective people wearing white lab coats, you know, extracting truths from nature, and their own passions. They are human after all. We are human after all. And those passions get written out. So I wanted to look at the sort of the rivalries, the excitement that scientists feel, and their attachment to the work, how they are invested. And a lot of scientists, including myself, we try really hard, but we are emotionally invested in some of the ideas. And what that does, it prevents us from being as open-minded as we need to be. And so in the book, I talk about each of these ideas and follow the arc of acceptance and the pushback from within the scientific community itself to the radical new idea. And since I was a child growing up in Delhi, I've been obsessed with maps. I was always interested in maps, both celestial and terrestrial maps. And so, and a lot of the work that I do, I really see it as mapping. and I'll show you some examples. So I've also tried to use maps both literally, sort of mapping as knowing, and then I also use maps as metaphorical devices. So a map actually codifies our current state of understanding. And through maps, we can actually see how our understanding has evolved. And this is much more salient in cosmology than really any other field. And so it's sort of very exciting to see how our cosmic view has evolved over time by just looking at representations of our cosmic view. And as I said, the other sort of exciting thing is the interplay of, you know, ideas and instruments that's playing out right now. So let me start out by showing you what I think are some of the most intriguing first representations of the cosmos. So probably ever since humans, sort of Neanderthals, stood upright, were able to look at the night sky, they were probably trying to make sense of sort of the awe and the wonder and the regularity of night and day, and so on. So the oldest known depiction of the night sky is the Nebrasky disk. Notice it's like 2,1600 BCE. So it was found in the Saxony-Anhalt region of Germany. And we believe that what is rendered here is the sun, the crescent moon, and the star cluster Pleiades. What they did with it, why they did this, why this representation, why it's a copper disk, we don't know. Right? We have no idea. But what we do know is later on, when we look at the 7th century BCE, that the Mesopotamians, sort of one of my favorite ancient civilizations, right? They were inveterate explorers of the cosmos. And so this is a tablet, one of many thousand, in which they made astronomical observations. This one charts the positions of the planet Venus. It's astounding, right? No, I mean, notice I said the planet Venus. They already knew that, you know, Venus was a planet and wasn't a star. And cuneiform is now deciphered, so we actually do know they were fairly accurate observations of Venus. I don't know why the screen is... do you know what's going on?
Why don't you just keep running on for a second?
Okay. So let me just, should I move it to the next? Oh, you're going to disconnect for a minute. Okay, so as I said, keeping with the cartographic theme, one of my other favorite maps, which, you know, we jump ahead now to about 1300s, the late 1300s, is this one. As I said, for a very, very long time, probably till about the 1400s, 1500s, what humans were really trying to do around the world, any civilization that you take, they were trying to make connections between the celestial and the terrestrial. They were not trying to yet look for explanations for why the heavens did what they did. But the first clue that we get from a map that they were starting to look for causation, right, an explanation, comes from this one. And so this is a rendition of the cosmic view in about 1300. So here it's an Aristotelian, Ptolemaic cosmos, where, of course, the Earth is in the center. And the intriguing thing here is that you see these two angels trying to turn the crank, and that's sort of the explanation for night and day, right? So this was sort of the first attempt, right? And of course, you know already that, you know, this is really sort of the full version of the Ptolemaic cosmos. So you have the Earth in the center of the solar system, or the cosmos, the entire cosmos, as we believed then. And you have the planets. And you have the planets that have been given divine forms, right? So there's Jupiter, Saturn, and so on. And so this was the view that, you know, everything revolved around the pivot being the Earth. Now, of course, we know that in 1543, Copernicus came along and really did a radical, radical transformation. He had this radical idea of shifting the pivot from the Earth to the Sun, right? And this idea was extremely radical and transformative and quite hard to grasp. And as we will see when I talk about some of the two other radical ideas later on, often when an extremely radical idea is proposed, it's not fully accepted as it is. So there's a transitory placeholder halfway house idea that becomes a little acceptable. And so that idea is not a complete reordering of the cosmos with the Earth and the Sun shifting to reorganize the solar system, but sort of a halfway house model that was actually proposed by Tycho Brahe. And Brahe's model, what you really had was, you know, the Earth was still at the center, and the Sun did revolve around the Earth, but perhaps the Sun could have a couple of planets of its own. So this was sort of the halfway house model that was proposed, right? And this we see as a phenomenon through in cosmology, definitely, and in many other fields, we have an idea that is so transformative, that is so different from the status quo, that you have to have periods of persuasion that take you slowly to the most radical version that is being proposed. And it takes time, and it takes persuasion and evidence. So in the case of science, obviously, the persuasion is by data and evidence. So, you know, finally, we have the reordered cosmos. And this is sort of where we were at out to the late 1800s and 1900s, except we had better and more accurate measurements of the orbits of the planets. They were better charted. And especially with the development of astrophotography, we really then had, we were able to have permanent records of the ephemeral in the night sky. So now you had these permanent records, photographic plates, images that could be taken, and that did not rely on the subjective drawings of an individual observer looking through a telescope. And so, and you had images that could be revisited by others because you had a record, right? So let's jump on right from there to where we are now. Okay, so this is where we are now. So we have an extremely detailed understanding of the cosmic drama that has unfolded in our universe. And we know that our universe began with a Big Bang, a hot, dense beginning about 13.8 billion years ago. And post that, there was a period of rapid exponential expansion of the universe, following which we know all of this because we have direct evidence from about when the universe was about 400,000 years old of the relic radiation from the Big Bang. So this is the cosmic microwave background radiation, the fluctuations in temperature of the photons that originated at that time as they filtered through when structure has, as structure is forming and assembling in our universe that we measure today. So what we know quite exquisitely, the timeline of when likely the first stars formed, about 200 million years. And then we also know how galaxies assemble, and we have a very credible theory that explains how all the structure that we see assembled from very, very small fluctuations very early on in time. And what we know is that dark matter, this sort of very puzzling component in the universe, which is the dominant matter component in the universe, is what structures the universe. It's the scaffolding in which galaxies form, and the initial fluctuations is the initial fluctuations in a sea of dark matter that have actually given rise to all the structure that we see. And so we have many, many independent lines of evidence that corroborate that theory, right? And so along with this sort of storyline, we also quite exquisitely know the composition of the universe, so the cosmic inventory. So if you look at this pizza here, you know that the bulk of the universe, the blue and the green, dark matter and dark energy, which constitute the bulk of the matter energy of the universe, we've charted them, but we don't know what they are. Okay, and what we know, the stuff that we're made of, all the elements that appear in the periodic table, for example, all the atoms, all the known atoms, they constitute a paltry 4% of the universe, right? So the interesting thing is we know that the bulk of the matter in the universe is dark matter, but we know that whatever this matter, we know it's matter because it has mass, so some particle likely formed very early in the universe. But we know a lot of things about the nature of this particle, although we've not yet found it. It remains elusive, right? So we know that dark matter does not absorb, emit, or reflect light. But we know that it deflects light, just like all matter in the universe, as we'll see. And that's actually one of the important ways in which we actually know that there is dark matter out there, right? Because it has gravity and therefore all the effects that gravity exerts on the motions of particles around, as well as the deflection of light, allow us to actually have, to provide this sort of inventory. And So I think one of the interesting conundrums at the moment is that the majority of the constituents of our universe, dark matter and dark energy, remain poorly understood. Okay? And however, there's empirical evidence for them. When I say they're poorly understood, is that we don't actually have, so in the case of dark matter, we've not found the particle. In the case of dark energy, we don't have a theoretical framework to really understand its true nature. Once again, dark energy was discovered empirically very recently, 1998. Two independent groups looked at the brightnesses of supernovae and found, by looking at distant supernovae, that the universe was not just expanding, as Hubble found in the 1920s, but that the expansion rate was accelerating. And as you all know, when you drive a car, if you want to accelerate the car, you need to hit the gas pedal, and so you're consuming some fuel, right? Something, some energy is fueling the acceleration. So what is fueling the accelerating expansion of the universe? We don't know what it is, and we call it dark energy. So it's observed, right? So it's observationally determined that, and it's a very secure observation, given the data, given the precision, right? So this is the deal with provisionality of science. To the best of our abilities today, given the errors in measurement, we know that we have a very secure determination of dark energy as the agency that is driving the exponential the accelerating expansion of the universe today. It turns out that it is very akin to the exponential expansion very early on in the universe, the inflationary period. So, there are theories. There are many theories that attempt to explain dark energy, and one of them is the sort of cyclical theory that, says you had this kind of peculiar expansion very early on, and what you're really seeing now at later times is a replication of that. So anyway, so what I want to do today really is to focus on two radical ideas. So I want to focus on the idea of dark matter and the idea of black holes. And I've picked them because they are somewhat similar. They're invisible entities that shape our universe in many ways. However, they're sort of different epistemically in terms of what they are, right? So they're both indirectly mapped, but how they were discovered, right, and how they became real, completely different stories. And so that's what I want to take you through. So the discovery of dark matter was entirely through observational data, and that the theoretical framework was sort of formulated afterwards. So, and black holes started out as a mathematical solution to Einstein's field equations. So they were a mathematical curiosity, and it took a long time for them to become real, in the sense to see that they actually correspond to real astrophysical objects in the universe. That took time. So these two ideas are sort of different. So the origin of the idea, it's very interesting that although the black hole solution is a mathematical solution to Einstein's field equations that came out of his theory of general relativity in 1915, 1916, even in the context of Newtonian gravity, in the idea of, Einstein kind of upended Newton, as we'll see in just a minute, he reconceptualized the nature of gravity. But even within the Newtonian context, where the force of gravitation is meant to be attractive between any two objects that have mass, and it's proportional to the product of their masses and falls off as the square of the distance between them. And at that time, the nature of light was believed light was believed to be corpuscular, made of particles called corpuscles. So the wave nature of light was not understood. So, however, in that framework, John Mitchell, who was a man of the cloth and who studied at Cambridge, realized that if you have a very massive star, then it could attract these particles of light and prevent them from flowing out again, could capture them. And the result would be that the star would be very dark. So this is sort of the sort of early analog that you could find to what would be a dark star. Not quite a black hole, as we'll see, but this is sort of, he came close. That's sort of conceptually kind of close. And the term, the term black hole began to be used in astrophysics by John Wheeler in about 1964. And later on, there were these intriguing astronomical objects, pulsars and quasars in the 60s and 70s that were discovered that actually made black holes real. And we realized that this mathematical solution actually described real objects in the universe and their properties, as we'll see. So, but for me, what was really intriguing is when I started thinking about this book, I started looking into what black holes really were. I found that, you know, it all goes back to India. So this one, this one, it turns out that was the term black hole actually predates, as I said, the astronomical object, right? It actually comes, it refers to a place, an infamous prison in Calcutta, where the local Nawab had imprisoned officers of the colonizing East India Company, soldiers, and he stuffed. There's a lot of disagreement on how many soldiers they actually captured. There are various accounts, but the point is that it was a point of no return. So, you know, they died overnight. They were asphyxiated. There was not enough oxygen, and so the black hole of Calcutta and this term black hole began to be used as a placeholder for, you know, it's a place of no return, right? And it turns out that it's a very, very apt description for an astrophysical black hole. So that was adopted in the 1960s. So there are many different ways to think about what a black hole really is. And as I said, it is a mathematical solution to the field equations. But one way that I have found very interesting to really understand their true nature is to think about the notion of escape speed. And so now, if you want to escape Earth's gravity, as you all know, if we launch a rocket to escape Earth's gravity, it has to be accelerated given a very high velocity, which the rocket boosters do, say at Cape Canaveral or something. And so the escape velocity from the Earth is about 300 times the speed of sound or something, right? So now if you imagine, and so if you give an object, you give it a velocity that exceeds the escape velocity, it will escape the grip of gravity of the Earth. Now, if the escape velocity was actually the speed of light, right? So that's what a black hole is. So a black hole is an astrophysical object whose gravity is so intense, that is so compact, it's a very compact distribution of mass, as we'll see in a minute, that the escape velocity from a black hole is actually the speed of light. And this is the reason why not even light escapes a black hole, and that's why it's black. And therefore, what we can really see about black holes are the effects that they exert in their vicinity, as we'll just see. So we infer the presence of black holes indirectly. Now, if we had to mimic the density and the strength of gravity of a black hole, we'd have to reduce all the matter in the Earth to the size of about a centimeter radius. And that's when you would mimic a black hole. That's how compact and dense a black hole would be, right? To just give you a sense. Now, that is all well and good, but, you know, how does this fit, you know, into the framework of our understanding of gravity, right? So it turns out what Einstein really did was reconceptualize Newton's gravity. Newton basically was able to explain what the gravitational force would be between any two objects. He was unable to explain why. Why is that so? And it took Einstein's profound insight and sort of this marriage of physics and geometry. It's a major conceptual breakthrough that he did, in which he was able to connect the shape of space, motions in space, to the distribution of matter. So he postulated that the universe can be thought of as a four-dimensional entity, a sheet called space-time. There's nothing above the space-time, nothing below space-time. We are all embedded in this four-dimensional sheet. And the reason you need it's four-dimensional is that time and space. So in order to describe any event that occurs in the universe, you need to describe not just where it happened, but when it happened. And you all know this is quite intuitive because, you know, it takes light 8 minutes to reach us from the sun. The sun is our nearest star. And just by extrapolation, you know, when you go out into the night sky, I gather tonight, alas, you won't be able to see much. It's a very cloudy night. But when you see these distant galaxies, light has taken millions, several cases for distant galaxies, billions of years to actually reach us. So we don't actually know what the night sky, what that galaxy looks like today. We just know what it looked like when life left, right? So you need these four coordinates to describe any event in the universe. So the other thing that Einstein realized, in his special theory of relativity, he also found that there's a cosmic speed limit, the speed of light. And there's a fundamental limit in the universe. So in his general theory of relativity, what Einstein was able to show that the presence of masses generates potholes or divots in space-time, this fabric of space-time. And so, for example, and the depth of this divot, the depth of this pothole, if you will, depends on the details of the composition of matter in the object. So any matter in the universe would create a little pothole. And the size of the pothole, the depth of the pothole, is going to depend on the mass and how the mass is distributed in that object. So if you look at the sun, it's a cartoon that shows you this would be the pothole that's generated by the sun. Now, if you take a neutron star, which is much more densely packed than the sun, you have a deeper divot in space-time. And pushing this along, when you have a black hole, you actually have a puncture in space-time. That's how dense and compact the matter is in a black hole. Okay? So when we think about the structure of a black hole, so the mathematical structure, and it turns out, as I'll show you, this does correspond now to our physical picture of the black hole as well. So we can think of the black hole as a solution to Einstein's field equations for a compact, dense mass that causes a puncture in space-time. And then it has this sort of boundary between visibility and invisibility, this region called the event horizon or the Schwarzschild radius, and light, matter, what have you, anything that crosses the event horizon is completely in the grip of the gravity of the black hole. It's the point of no return. So not even light signals can actually exit the event horizon. But then there are some of these other interesting regions around the black hole. So there's a region called the photon radius where light can be perpetually orbiting if it happens to be to reach there. Sort of like, you know, Dante's purgatory, so you're sort of in limbo. And of course, if you get pushed slightly, you go in, or you could actually escape. So these are sort of the regions of the black hole. And the reason I'm showing you this is because when we study astrophysical black holes, no, we haven't quite gotten here, but there's a current exciting ongoing experiment that you might have read about in the newspapers the last couple of weeks that's run out of the Center for Astrophysics. It's called the Event Horizon Telescope. And what they plan to do is they plan to map the shadow of light that is just skirting around the event horizon. And I can just show you what they are trying to do with my first image. So this Event Horizon Telescope is trying to map this kind of ring structure, the shape of the shadow, around the black hole that is at the center of our galaxy, the Milky Way. So one of the other interesting things that happens around black holes, because it's space-time that is bent, is the nature of time gets distorted. So as you get closer and closer to a black hole, time actually slows down. Okay, so... What is the astrophysical connection to black holes? So we think that black holes are the end state of stars. So when stars form, they exhaust their fuel, they leave behind black holes. And so black holes start out with small masses, they grow over time, and the way in which we think they grow over time is by the accretion, which is a fancy of saying gobbling of gas. And the gas is kept around a black hole. It sits around a black hole. It settles around a black hole in the form of a disk that's called an accretion disk. So let me just go back and show you this slide one more time. So this is the Hubble Space Telescope image of a nearby galaxy, and we are zooming in, and we're going to reach a point where we will no longer, we are moving into an artist's impression at this point. We do not have the instruments to resolve this particular region, the innermost feeding regions for the black hole, well outside the event horizon, about 10 to the 4, you know, 10,000 times the event horizon or so. And there's a disk kind of structure from which gas kind of fuels and funnels down to the center. And then black holes, we know, produce these jets, and these are seen. Okay, so we often see these. So we have these telltale signs. So you have this black hole that is feeding. You can't quite resolve exactly how it's feeding. We can't resolve the innermost regions quite yet with data. But what we do see are sort of the aftermath, sort of the activity, the clues that a black hole leaves behind, where you see these very large jets, very large scale jets that are launched that we see around the centers of many galaxies that host active black holes. So it turns out that black holes in the universe, we now think that black holes probably are sitting in the center of most, if not all, galaxies. However, they occur in two states. So they're either feasting or they're fasting. So feasting black holes are seen as quasars. And these are basically black holes, often supermassive black holes, about a million to a billion times the mass of the sun, in the centers of galaxies, gas-rich centers of galaxies that are actively feeding. And in fact, they're so bright that they will outshine all the stars in the galaxy. And these quasars are what we see out to great cosmic distances. They're sort of some of the brightest beacons in the universe. That's how we know that we have these very active black holes very early on in the universe. However, in the nearby universe, and this is an image of an infrared image of the inner regions of our galaxy, which we know contains a black hole that is about 4 million times the mass of the sun, it's gas-starved, it's not feeding, it's just sitting there. Okay, so this is not shining. And so the reason quasars are shining is as the gas funnels through, the gas is sped up, it's heated, and it starts glowing in the X-rays, in the optical, and that's what gives you the quasar phenomenon. Okay, so this is the dying gasps of the gas as it's making its way down to the black hole. That's what we see. So as far as we know, the black hole in the center of our galaxy is currently not feeding, or if it's feeding at very, very piddly rates. You know, it's essentially fasting, right? So the question is, how do we know we have a black hole there? Are we sure that there's a black hole there? So it turns out that the effect on the motions of the stars, there are stars nearby which are far enough away that they're not going to get ripped out, right? So the intense gravity of the black hole, the intense gravity of the event horizon and all of that region, the puncture in space-time, so these stars are actually sampling much further out. So they're pretty safe. They're not actually going to be gobbled by the black hole. They're far enough away, but they're close enough to actually feel the gravity of the black hole. And so what we now know, so these are the locations of some of the stars that are nearby in the inner regions of our galaxy that are circling the black hole, that are held in its grip, but are not on course to be falling into the black hole. And what's very interesting in this regime, where you don't have to worry about general relativity, you and Newton's laws are fine because we are not in the strong gravitational grip of the black hole. So Newton's laws are very good at approximation. And what that means, as most of you probably know, that the motions of these stars are basically going to be nice Keplerian ellipses, right? So this is real data, and you can see the date. This is a movie from data. So there are two very active groups, Andrea Goetz and her group at UCLA, and Reinhard Genzel and his group in Germany. And so this is the data from the Germans. And what you saw here are the stars and their orbits. And this little blob was a gas blob that's called G2 that kind of strayed close a few years ago. And we expected a major gobbling event. It didn't happen. It was sort of stripped and sort of the gas is oozed back. And so what you see, this is a prediction. So what you saw till 2016 was the real data. And after that, these are predictions of the model of what's going to happen to the gas. And maybe I should show it one more time. So notice here you see these ellipses closing, and that's how you know where the black hole is, because as we know in the solar system, right, that the orbits of the planets are elliptical and the sun is at one focus, so we can figure out where the gravitationally dominant object, the black hole, is, and we know its location. Notice G2, and this is the prediction of its orbit. It'll come back around, so we may have a couple of possible tries, predictions for seeing some of this gas getting gobbled by the black hole in the center of the Milky Way. Notice the stars continue unperturbed. Right. Okay, so as I mentioned, bright quasars are actually growing black holes, and this shows you a quasar. And remember, it outshines the galaxy. If I remove all the light from the quasar in the inner regions, out pops the galaxy. It's a nice spiral galaxy, but it is dwarfed. Its brightness, all the light produced by all the stars in the galaxy is dwarfed by that produced by the quasar, the growing black hole. So this is an old simulation that I did with one of my collaborators a very long time ago now. But the idea here was to, as I said, the whole theory of structure formation that we have has another element built into it, which is, it's driven by dark matter and so on. So you form the first galaxies, and the structure assembles by collisions of galaxies. And now if every galaxy, I'm telling you, is already planted with a black hole in the center, the question is, when galaxies collide, what happens to the black holes, right? So this is a very early simulation now, more 15 years ago now, but where we sort of originally looked at this idea of what would be the effect of two black holes, binary black holes, merging. And, in the context of what I've just told you about this gas disk that's feeding, what really happens? Do we see anything? So what you're going to see is a movie. You're seeing a top view of a black hole, a very supermassive black hole, about, 50 million times the mass of the sun that's sitting in the center here. And you're going to have a secondary that's going to get plopped on. This red thing is the disk. And this is the side view of the disk. So the disk basically contains gas, and it's piled up in the center. The black hole is somewhere here. This is the cross section. And it sort of falls off like this. Sort of it oozes off like this, the disk. And what you're going to see is a secondary black hole that gets plopped onto the disk, and you're going to see how it actually makes its way in. So it'll take a little while to see it. You can see the secondary has just plopped on here. I hope you can see the contrast. Very soon you'll start seeing it delving down. And notice the disk starts to get rearranged because of the secondary that has starting to plow into the center. And then something very, very intriguing happens. And we notice this for the first time, which is that the secondary carves out a sort of a gap in the disk. Sort of, it carves out this region. You have this gap. It kind of separates out the inner part of the disk from the outer part of the disk. Okay, and then it eventually, obviously, merges. And you all saw when two black holes merge, you actually have an earthquake, a tremor in space-time, and that was measured last year for two black holes. But these are much much wimpier black holes than the ones that I've been talking about. So I'm especially interested in ones that are supermassive black holes, a million times the mass of the sun or more. So this, of course, was to about 30 solar mass black holes that collided and were discovered by the LIGO collaboration. So what I'm really waiting for, and I hope this window opens in my lifetime. So this was the LIGO event, the gravitational wave, the strength of gravitational waves. It's called the strain versus the frequency. And this was the LIGO detection that we saw. The supermassive black holes that I'm interested in, they merge, as we know. That's how structure forms in the universe. And their merger will produce much lower frequency. And in order to detect those events, you actually need the kind of apparatus you had on the ground in LIGO, those kind of interferometers. You need them in space. So the Europeans are planning a mission called LISA. I think within the next 20 years, we should maybe see a detection of gravitational waves from the merger of two supermassive black holes. Okay, moving right along to the idea of, now I switch gears to talk about dark matter. And so what I want to show you here is that, many of you are sort of interested in the history of science, right? And you've noticed that, there was the idea of ether, and it was another invisible entity, and it went away. The question is, is dark matter something like that? Is it also going to go away? So my job now is to convince you that, no, dark matter is very different from ether. And that's because of the kind of observational evidence that we have at the moment. And there have been challenges because we haven't found the particle, right? But there is not yet a convincing alternative model, okay? And the two sort of lines of evidence that I'll be showing you are from the impact, just like that of a black hole. We saw the impact of the gravity of the black hole in its vicinity. We're going to look at, because it's matter again, on the motions of stars, and the impact of dark matter on the paths of light rays, so the deflection that it causes in light rays. So the discovery of dark matter once again, as I talked, remember I talked about radical ideas and how sometimes you have this sort of halfway house, you kind of have this halfway house understanding before you really accept the full idea. In the case of the dark matter and of for many other extraordinary ideas, another feature is that it has to be discovered, rediscovered, and rediscovered many times before it really becomes accepted. So this is one particular, in the case of dark matter, it was the idea was actually discovered, proposed, and kind of forgotten, and then it was rediscovered later. So in 1933, Fritz Zwicky, who was a bit of a cantankerous Swiss astronomer at Caltech, found measuring the speeds of galaxies in a nearby cluster of galaxies called the Coma Cluster. So basically a cluster of galaxies is about 1,000 galaxies that are somehow held together by gravity. Okay? And so he measured the speeds of galaxies in this cluster and found that they were moving around really fast, much faster than would be permitted if the only gravity was provided by the stars in all the galaxies. There are about 1,000 galaxies. And if you sum up all the mass of all the stars in the galaxies, the gravitational influence of that would be insufficient by a factor of 10 to account for the speeds of the galaxies in the cluster. So he proposed that maybe there is some invisible matter that is exerting gravity. It has to be matter, and he called it Dunkel materie, dark matter. And that must be holding galaxy clusters together. You know, the thing with Zwicky is he had a lot of brilliant ideas. He had a million ideas a minute. And, you know, he didn't have a bad hit rate, but, you know, he did have a hit rate. So he had a lot of duds. He had some brilliant ideas. He had a lot of duds. And so when he proposed this idea, people were like, meh, you know, this must be one of the duds. It was kind of radical, right? And so it sort of wasn't taken up seriously. Then in 1937, but he didn't quite give up, right? And he's like, well, you know, let me think a little bit more. How can I persuade people? So in 1937, he used Einstein's formulation of space-time and this whole concept that I just talked about with all these potholes and this calculation, because you remember light has to travel on space-time. So if you will, light will carry an imprint of every pothole that it has traversed and it has encountered. So he was able to show that the deflection of light caused by every pothole would accumulate, and you should be able to see and have an observable effect in the light that we measure on Earth from distant galaxies, the light that emanates from distant stars and distant galaxies that has encountered, say, a cluster of galaxies en route to us that has a lot of dark matter. There's a huge pothole, a huge divot that would cause a huge deviation in its path. So it turns out he made that calculation, it was right, but at the time we didn't have the instruments to be able to measure that deflection. So once again, that whole thing died out till the 1970s, where Vera Rubin and her collaborators, Kent Ford and Thonard, looked at the problem in a completely different way. They were not aware of Zwicky's work, they didn't know about the idea of dark matter. What they found, they started measuring the speeds of stars around an individual galaxy. So if you look at the speeds of stars from the center outward of a galaxy, they started looking at those speeds and they found that the stars were moving around much, much faster, much like the clusters, much like the galaxies around a cluster, right? Except they didn't make that connection, right? And so what is expected if all the, if the entire gravitational force that powers the motion, that propels the motion of these stars is provided by what is seen, the stars and the gas, then the curve that you expect, this is called a rotation curve, the speeds of the stars would sort of rise up slowly, sort of reach a peak, and then they would fall off as you run out of matter and you run out of gravity as you reach the outskirts of the galaxy. But what they measured was this white curve. It's very, very puzzling, right? So they actually sat on their data for a couple of years. They weren't sure what they were seeing, and they realized that there was something else contributing to the gravity. But, you know, they waited. To show you how peculiar this is, let's look at an example closer to home. If you look at the solar system and you look at the sun and you look at the planets and you look at the speeds of the planets around the sun, and remember the sun is the dominant, most massive, gravitating body in the solar system, and the speeds of planets around the sun falls as you go further out. So, and notice I've talked about, you know, scientists' blind spots. Mine is Pluto. It's still a planet. I just can't give it up. I'm just not able to give it up. Okay, so it's my childhood memories are tied to Pluto, and so you know, if you look at the speeds of planets, it actually declines as you go further out in the solar system. That tells you that the gravitationally dominant body is the sun, and it's in the center. And so this is sort of the rotation curve of our solar system, if you will, right? So now let's look again at the contrast of what Vera Rubin, Ford, and Thonard actually found for many, many galaxies. So they found that somehow this should suggestively already show you that probably there is matter all the way out to very large distances. So it's almost like something is holding up a galaxy in the outskirts, right? So this is what was pretty radical. So as I said, eventually, of course, it was accepted. And in fact, we now believe that, as I told you, the dark matter structure is the entire universe. And in fact, every galaxy is a cartoon of what we believe galaxies look like today. They have a huge halo of dark matter. So you have a pileup of dark matter in the center and an extended dark matter halo. And what we see as the stars are the inner, just sort of the tip of the iceberg. We see a small portion of the mass of the galaxies actually revealed to us in the gas, the dust, and the stars. Okay, so let's now go back to the other line of evidence, which is the bending of light. So coming back to our notions of space-time, we already know that the presence of matter, so this is a cartoon of a cluster of galaxies that is intervening, that lies between us and the light from a distant galaxy. So light rays from a distant galaxy that arrive at us and encountering the dark matter in the cluster that has caused a huge divot in space-time gets deviated. And what's the effect of a deviation? What do I mean by deviation? Can you see it? Absolutely. So this is a Hubble Space Telescope image of, and actually this is of an individual galaxy, as we saw my cartoon of a galaxy with the big dark matter halo. And what's happening here is we know that what you have is an intervening bright galaxy with a huge dark matter halo. And this is the light from a distant galaxy, which is a little blue smudge. And the deflection of the light rays causes this galaxy to appear completely bent into an arc. Okay? And so this, you know, this effect, this bending, manifests itself as a change in shape, as a distortion in shape. And in fact, it turns out sometimes the distortion, the divot, the pothole can be so deep that if you think of a ray of light as a little tube, if you will, that this tube can actually get split. And so you end up even seeing multiple images of the same object. So in reality, you have one object, but you end up seeing copies of it, okay, projected on the sky. And you see that. So this is now an image of cluster of galaxies, Abel 2218, one of the early Hubble images. I mean, I like to call it the Brad Pitt and Angelina, pre-split of the Brangelina, Brad Pitt, Angelina Jolie of clusters, because it's extremely photographed. I mean, it's very interesting, but it's not the most interesting cluster that we know of. I'll show you the one that we think is the most intriguing cluster in terms of its dark matter distribution, right? So what you can all see now by eye, you can all probably pick up the gravitationally lensed distant galaxies. And by looking at this lens, so the yellow smudgy things are the cluster. This is the foreground lens that is doing the distortion in the space-time. And what you're seeing here as stretched out arcs and arclets are the distant galaxies that lie beyond, right? And so you can, you know, at this point, you should all be able to see immediately, this is a cluster that has two big distributions of mass. Something here, because you can see all the deflections around here, and some mass that's piled up here, because you see some other deflections around here, right? So that's what a lot of, this is sort of what I have been working on for many years, and now there are many, many research groups as well that do this, and what we do is we convert the Hubble Space Telescope data. And of course, you need spectroscopic information, so you need to know where these galaxies are. You need to be sure that they're actually background and they're getting lensed, and they're not galaxies that are born with peculiar shapes, right? So one of the reasons we know how to do this mapping to back out how much dark matter that we have is that clusters of galaxies are the most massive structures in the universe. They've assembled very recently, so luckily they're very rare. So most of the universe, when you look out, it's not distorted. So we know the undistorted shapes of galaxies, the distribution with which, range and shapes with which galaxies are born. So when we look through a region where we know there's a cluster, we will see that the shapes are really distorted. We can figure out the using the undistorted as a prior, we can look at the distorted shapes and we can back out all the matter that is piled along in a cylinder, dark matter mostly, in the cluster, we can map that out. And so we produce these kind of maps. So this is a map of the dark matter in that cluster, ABEL 2218 that we saw, and I've switched the back and front. So this is the bigger pile of dark matter, this is the smaller pile. And so you'll see the bigger pile of dark matter here and the smaller pile. And what this has shown, as I told you, one of the things about dark matter is it aggregates in the universe. Because it has gravity, it has matter, it aggregates, it piles up in the universe, right? And so what we see is a gradual sort of smooth mound of dark matter, and you see a lot of other clumps of dark matter. So this is sort of, and you know, this is all derived from the lensing data. So we know, and there's a lot more matter here than in just the stars in the galaxies in this cluster. So to wrap up, let me show you what is the state of the art. So this is one of the most recent, deepest images of the Hubble Space Telescope of a cluster of galaxies. And this is a cluster that's very, very massive. In fact, it's a bunch of clusters that are crashing into each other. And this is a part of a project called the Frontier Fields Project. And the Hubble Space Telescope stared at this patch of sky equivalently for about 3 months. So it's one of the deepest kind of images that we have. And you can see the large number of distorted arcs and arclets that you can pick up. So there are about 1,000 or so distorted shapes in this image, originating from several hundred background galaxies that lie beyond this lens. And so here is a reconstruction from my research group of the dark matter that you don't see in this image, shown in blue. Okay? So you have dark matter. As you can see, by and large, it traces the galaxies, traces the light, but there's a huge amount of dark matter. And so, you know, it's harder to see how it's piled up. Let me show you one of the highest resolution dark matter maps ever produced. And this is the dark matter in that region of sky that we just saw, now rendered three-dimensionally to show you how it's piled up. Okay, so the question is, you might say, oh, this is great, but you know, why are you mapping? Why are you so obsessed with me? We understand you like maps, but you know, why? What are you getting out of this one, right? So remember, you know, I think the analogy that I really like is, now we now, what we are trying to do, right, is we are trying to map sand dunes, how they've piled up, and we're trying to figure out the nature of a grain of sand. We're trying to find clues. That's sort of what we're doing, really. But there's something deeper that you can actually do rather than sort of, you know, sit and read beautiful poetry by Szymborska. It talks about, you know, view in the grain of a sand or whatever. So what we're really doing is the current theoretical model, as I said, in which dark matter we believe to be these particles that move around very sluggishly, a particle that formed very early in the universe, that has gravity, that barely interacts with each other or with anything else, just aggregates via gravity. And we believe that one other peculiar thing about this dark matter particle attribute it would have is it would be collisionless. It would not actually collide as we are used to. Imagine billiard balls and so on, they kind of graze past each other. So the interesting thing is we are able to work out, as I said, how structure assembles and is structured by dark matter. Everything that we see in the universe is driven by dark matter, so we can now do computer simulations. And so what we can do is we can run a simulation of a patch of the universe, a region, for example, that's going to form a cluster of galaxies like we see in the Hubble data. And we can see if the nature of dark matter was not cold dark matter, say if it was a slightly different nature, if it's warm dark matter, so these are particles that would actually interact with each other, more familiar kind of, familiar to our daily experience of gas and things like that. Then you will see from this very high resolution simulation why I'm obsessed with mapping the clumps of dark matter. Cold dark matter is extremely clumpy. And what you're seeing here is all dark matter, although it's lit up to look like light. It's just mocked up to look like light. This is all dark matter particles, okay? And their gravitational aggregation. And here you're seeing a dark matter particle with a fundamentally different nature and how it would aggregate. And notice that one of the clues, these two pictures are very, very different. If I can tabulate all the clumps that are, that's why I'm trying to produce grainier and more granular representations of the dark matter inferred from gravitational lensing. So you might say, okay, where are we at? Well, it turns out that, you know, we've not yet detected the dark matter, right? And this is one of the reasons why we are all trying to figure out indirect ways to hone in on its nature. And then you might ask, that's all great, but Priya, what do you think you're doing? If you're not going to find the dark matter particle, it's a pretty disappointing career to have had, right? You can't find this. You can't really map black holes. You know, what are you really doing, right? So it turns out that, you know, what drives me and a lot of other people, right, is that we're really trying to do tests of our understanding of gravity, sort of profound understanding of gravity. And what we're looking for is gaps. So a disagreement between theoretical predictions from, say, Einstein's theory and data. And the reason for that, and you'll say, okay, that's great, you found the gap. Aha, but it turns out, aha, there's something very interesting about the kinds of gaps that you find, right? So if you look at history and you look at the case of, say, the orbit of Uranus, right? So when people started mapping, getting better data for the orbit of Uranus, it was discovered that it doesn't quite fit Newton's prediction. And there's a slight deviation in the orbit. You know, and this was 1800s, and, you know, Newton's laws were sacred. This is pre-Einstein. So Newton's laws were sacred and caused a bit of attention amongst physicists, like, what's really going on? So it turns out there's a clever French mathematician, applied mathematician, Urbain Lavoisier, who said, aha, I have the solution. What's really happening is you have another gravitating body in the solar system. You have another planet whose orbit actually crosses Uranus occasionally. So you are perturbing the orbit of Uranus. So he predicted the existence of Neptune. They went and looked, and they found it. So Newton's laws were intact, right? So it turns out that there was another problem, which was a deviation in the orbit of Mercury. And Urbain Le Verrier said, aha, the same solution. He said, you know, he was a clever guy, but he said, oh, yeah, well, you know, I think we have the same problem here. You have another planet, Vulcan, in between the sun and Mercury, and that is causing perturbations. And people went around and looked for Vulcan, solar eclipses, and so on. Some people said they saw it. There is no Vulcan, okay? So there was no planet. So it turns out that this discrepancy, in order to understand that discrepancy, you know, Einstein's theory of general relativity was needed. A complete reconceptualization of the theory was required in order to explain. That's not what motivated Einstein to come up with general relativity, but it turns out it's one of the powerful predictions of his theory, the precession of the orbit of Mercury, right? So the thing is, when we find a gap, we don't know if we are in the Uranus situation or in the Mercury situation. What we do know is that Einstein's theory of general relativity is not the final word. We know that it's an incomplete theory, but there has to be a theory that's a covering theory that will have to a broader set of explanations than Einstein. Just as Newton has his domain of validity, Einstein's theory has a domain of validity, and that there has to be another covering theory. And we believe that because we believe in nature, all the forces are unified. And at the moment, the larger scale forces, gravity, are not unified with quantum mechanics. And so this has been the quest of string theory. No success quite yet, but, you know, we know that there is a lot more. So any new pointers to what that new theory might be is going to come from the gaps. So that's what people like me are trying to do with our research work, trying to confront the best possible data sets that we can have at the moment with the best and the clearest theoretical understanding and calculations that we can make, and then seeing how they line up or not. Anyway, thank you so much for your attention. I'd be happy to answer questions.
If dark energy is E sub d and dark matter is M sub d, does E sub d equals
M sub d c squared? No. Unfortunately, I mean, this is the dream that many of us have, that somehow the
these two dark entities would be related to each other. We collapse the two problems into one. We're done. Alas, no. And, you know, there have been people that tried to make models like that, but they don't work.
Is the only evidence for dark energy the fact that the expansion of the universe seems to be accelerating? Is there any other evidence for that?
Yeah, no, there's a lot more evidence because of the acceleration of the universe. There are signatures on the clustering of galaxies. So the spaces, you know, how closely you would find galaxies around any given galaxy, those signatures, yeah. And there would be, far, you know, there, you can actually see a variation in the clustering length, for example. So that's all detected. In fact, Doug has worked on the cosmic microwave background, which also another line of evidence that suggests that, you know, the from the energy content of the universe, that you need something, some component that makes it add up to one. And the matter that we measure accounts for about 0.3, and you need this other thing that gives you a contribution of about 70%. So the cosmic microwave background radiation, clustering of galaxies, and many, many, again, many, many independent lines. The most compelling and the first one came from the supernovae data in 1998. Yeah.
I read your book, and the epilogue of your book, you said that the digital age is, like, very important to scientists. Could you, like, expand on that, like, explain how scientists should try to promote science, and also how to get scientists to promote more science than just their field?
Yeah. So I think that's a great question. I think that, you know, one of the things, since you read the book, one of the things that I also chart is how the doing of science has actually changed, and that how, you know, in science we have been fixated with a certain archetype of a scientist, so this, you know, lone male genius with unkempt hair and coming up with these great thoughts, you know, entirely on his own. And it turns out that, you know, they do even those chaps, actually there was a lot of background, there was a lot of work that other people did. It's always been collaborative. Science has always been collaborative. And now more so than ever. So we have work is done in very large collaborations and with all different kinds of expertise, right? And so I think that the narrative of how scientists present what they do has inherently has to be complex now. It has to be very complex. And I think that what we need to do as scientists is to get the public to appreciate complexity. And yet try to, you know, explain it as clearly as we possibly can. And I think that's that is a responsibility. However, as I said, right, there's a research by one of my colleagues called Dan Pihan, who runs the center called the Center for Cultural Cognition at Yale. And so he has been looking at, you know, why there is disbelief in science. Is it because scientists are just not good enough or not doing enough to explain what they're doing, right? The process of science, as I said, you know, are they not telling us, you know, how collaborative it is, how many different kinds of skills you need, and so on and so forth. And it turns out that that's not what is causing the disbelief in science. So, and it was very troubling, exciting to see his results. So when he looks, right, he's looking for correlation. So he looked at, he did surveys, and he tried to look for correlations between education, the level of scientific education, and their belief in science, right? No correlation. So it turns out there's only one thing that very strongly correlates on whether you believe in science or not. And it turns out that it is your larger worldview, which is, and you can break it down, it breaks into two, unfortunately, kinds of maps politically as well. It is whether you have an individualist point of view or you have a more community-based socialist point of view. And it turns out that, therefore, your belief in science and what science can do and in its power is correlated to your sense, your tribal sense of where you belong, right? So in a way, what we really need to do as scientists in the future, and what your generation, for example, will need to do, will have to leverage a lot more of our understanding of cognitive neuroscience to know how people change their minds about things, how to get people to change their minds. You know, and right now, right, this is a very, very important conversation socially right now, because where you're living in times that are very, very polarized, people really think very differently. And I think that particularly the attitude to science is something we've got to pull out of that sort of your identity, your tribal identity, or belonging to one group or the other. I think that's what we have to focus on. Having said that, I should now advertise that we have a March for Science, and that tells me there's a Boston version. Please join in. It's kind of sad we have to march, but you know, I think if that's what it takes, we're happy to do that. But a great question.
Could you go back to your slide with the timeline, please?
Yeah, of the universe?
Yes. I was just wondering how confident you are in a number such as 379,000 out of 13.8 billion.
Actually, incredibly confident. Within an error, margin of error, of course. It's not one particular incident.
Right.
It's a margin of error. So about 400,000 years. And we're actually pretty damn sure of that number.
Can you explain how you got to that number?
Yeah, so as I said, there's a framework in which we know how structure assembles in the universe, and we also know how it starts to assemble, and we also know how the universe from its hot, dense state started to expand out, when it originally consisted primarily of radiation, and then you moved to having radiation and matter start to dominate, and then matter starts to dominate, radiation is secondary. So, you know, we know the epochs of the universe, the various stages, the growth stages. So we're able to pinpoint the infancy of the universe, the childhood, the adolescent years, and so on and so forth, of the universe, because they're often marked by transitions in physical processes that leave behind observational signatures. So we are able to, so for example, we know that we lived in around 400,000 years, We had primarily radiation, no assembled structures, and that what we are seeing is this radiation that is filtering through the stuff that's forming later on. So we're really able to kind of, we know when the first galaxies can start to form, because you know you need these dark matter, sort of cosmic webs of dark matter in which ordinary gas, mostly hydrogen, falls in, cools, collapses, forms stars, becomes denser and forms stars. We know the time that it takes for those. We know when these this gas is going to fall in. So you know we're able to time it, I would say, exquisitely well, given that you know it's 13.7 billion
right.
years. Yeah, I mean there is give. You know, it's there is give there in terms
the punch
of
the factor.
Yeah, there's a patch of time. This is roughly 379 to 400,000 years. Yeah.
Whose clock is measuring 379,000 years?
It's our clock.
No, but the gravity there is enormous. So the clock is going slow.
Oh, yeah, good point. No. But, you know, the gravity there is not actually enormous. We're still in a weak, we're not in a regime that is, remember, that's the size of the entire universe. The entire universe was compact. So we are measuring, the clock is set by setting t equals zero in the very early universe, and knowing the current age of the universe. So you know, that's what sets our clock, right? The entire clock.
Up here.
Yeah. And if you're asking whether general relativity is relevant, no, general relativity is not relevant at the time. So this is an epoch. The early epochs in the universe are when the particle physics and quantum effects are much more important compared to general relativistic effects.
You have a question up there.
Up here.
Oh, sorry, I
can't. It's okay. Yeah. I know when we use the Einstein field theory, the equations to model our universe, we assume that the universe is flat, but how can we be sure that the universe itself does not have any curvature?
So what we know is that the universe is a great question. So what we know when we use, so you know, Einstein's field equations tell us that the contents, the geometry, and the fate of the universe are intricately linked. So this was his profound insight, right? That's what his equations tell you. So if you know two, you know the third. If you know the contents and you know the fate of the universe, you know the geometry of the universe, the shape of the universe. So what we know is that the observational evidence tells us that the universe is globally flat. It does not mean that there aren't inhomogeneities on small scales. So right around, obviously, whenever you have galaxies and so on, there are going to be these potholes, right? So by and large, the universe on scales of about 1,000 megaparsecs is flat, corresponds to flat. And that observations bear that out. Now we have these large surveys where we're able to go out to very, very large distances, and we can corroborate that.
So I thought you were going to combine your two themes, and I'll ask why you didn't. So there's all this matter in the universe that we can't see, and black holes are this matter that we can't see. So
they're not necessarily related.
Okay, but why is that not plausible?
Well, it's been suggested.
Black holes. Okay.
So the amount of dark matter that is needed in the universe to explain the light deflection and all the motions that we see, we just cannot make black holes to account for all of it. There was a recent attempt when one of my colleagues tried to say that maybe the dark matter consists of little black holes, like the black holes that LIGO found colliding, maybe that's what it is. So it turns out that given the amount of dark matter that we need and the spatial distribution that we need, when we need to form it and how much of that we need to form, there are real problems in using just the black holes as all dark matter. Believe me, people have tried. Okay. People are trying to collapse, you know, as many of these dark entities into one and solve, you know, like solve them in one go. But there was one more question. Yeah.
Is it possible for something to collide into a black hole and shatter it into smaller pieces?
And then shatter the black hole into small pieces, you mean?
Yeah.
No, that's not the way to think about a black hole. Because once something collides with a black hole, as I said, right, the black hole really corresponds to a puncture in space-time. So if you're saying, can you disrupt the black hole? So that's what happens when two black holes collide. They disrupt each other. So if you can think of it as having these two big funnels in space-time, when those two black holes that we saw in the LIGO result, when they actually collapse and they become one, in some sense, visually, you're making a bigger funnel. So that's the closest that the universe gets to what you want it to do.
Yeah? Since dark matter interacts gravitationally, and in fact only gravitationally, can you have enough dark matter to collapse into a black hole? Does it attract itself enough to become that?
Great question. So it turns out that because dark matter is actually collisionless, you cannot condense it close enough. You can't compact it enough, make it dense enough to actually become a black hole. However, a black hole can eat dark matter. I mean, it can eat anything, right? I'm in a joke that, you know, whenever I do my laundry, I'm like missing my socks, right? So mismatched socks can be going into the black hole. But that's the interesting thing about black holes. Whatever goes in, you have no idea what has gone in. Right? So when you see, when we measure the mass of the black hole in the center of the Milky Way, it's 4 million times the mass of the sun. We have no idea whether, you know, 5% of it was from the dark matter that was in the inner regions that went in, or is it all gas? Was it, we have no idea. So, you know, that's another big unsolved problem in black hole physics, which is sort of this information paradox. So information is just another sort of way of saying that you don't actually know the nature of what fell in once it crosses the event horizon. And so, you know, this is a big open question. And, you know, Stephen Hawking has this very nice analogy, and I think I'll close out with that, is that, you know, and the paradox is this, right? Suppose you have the Encyclopedia Britannica, and I want to look up the capital of Ghana. It's Accra, I look it up, and I read about it, whatever, right? Then imagine that I have a box, I burn the Encyclopedia Britannica, and I keep all the ashes inside a box. No ash has left the box. Everything is in there, right? So the information that Accra is the capital of Ghana is in that box, right? Except we don't know how to retrieve it anymore. And we also no longer know how that information is stored, right? Once the paper and the ink have been destroyed, we don't actually know in the ashes how that information could be encoded. So in a way, that is the conundrum with black holes and the event horizon, right? So we don't actually know what is happening once you cross the event horizon. The event horizon is like that box, and the information about what fell in, etc., is like the ashes. And so we don't actually have the language at the moment to understand that.
So one of the wonderful things about observatory nights is there's no end to the question. it's a good rule of thumb that when the black hole information paradox comes up.